Let's look at splitting methods a little bit more generally. Okay? So far, the driving example has always been AU equals F, where we're trying to solve U. And the choice of U and F came from the fact that traditionally, when solving Poisson equations, you use U for the function that you're trying to solve for, and F for the force vector, for the force function. Now, we like using X and Y. So let's actually continue now our discussion with X and Y. And so far, we've taken our matrix A and we have partitioned it into the diagonal minus the negative of the lower, strictly lower triangular part minus the transpose of that. And now we want to do it more generally, where actually the matrix does not necessarily need to be symmetric. And therefore, we are going to replace this with a U. Okay, so that is the negative of the strictly upper triangle part of the matrix. And we can use U because we won't be confused with the vector U that we had before, because we've switched here to the vector X in that position. All right, we're all aboard? So, we can then come up with different splitting methods. But actually, we can get away from all of these details altogether and simply say, well, let's do an analysis of what happens when you take your matrix A and you split it into a matrix M and a matrix N, and your method then becomes you solve with M in this way, as you've seen before, except now using X and Y instead of U and F. Okay, and this was the general formulation of the splitting method, where for the Jacobi iteration, M was the diagonal, N was everything else, well, the negative of everything else. For Gauss-Seidel, M was the lower triangular matrix, N was the transpose of the stricter lower triangle part, except negated, etc., etc., etc. Okay? So the question now is, how can we show that the sequence of vectors xk actually converges to the answer? Okay, and for that we're going to do a little bit of theory. Now, we know that this is true, but we also know that the actual solution must satisfy this right here. Why? Because we want A times X to be equal to Y. If we plug in M minus N for A, then we can bring the minus N times X to the other side, and therefore this is actually equivalent to stating this right here. What you can then do is say, okay, let's take this equation and subtract it off of that equation. Happily, the Y's cancel each other. And what you get is that M times the quantity xk plus 1 minus the actual solution is equal to N times xk minus the actual solution. Okay, and this is good because now we're talking about how close is xk plus 1 to x relative to how close xk was to x. And then it actually becomes beneficial to bring M to the other side. So we get that xk plus 1 minus x is equal to M inverse times N times xk minus x. Ah, and then we can take norms. Okay, because we can say, oh, we know that the norm of this is just equal to the norm of this. And then if we use a submultiplicative matrix norm or a subordinate matrix norm or whatever you want to call it, then we know that this is less than or equal to M inverse N times XK minus X. this obviously is less than or equal to m inverse n squared times xk minus 1 minus x, because we can just sort of telescope this out. And if you do that many, many times, then you can bring the original vector x0 into the picture. And you can see that this right here should be m inverse n to, good question, to what power? Well, if you look at it, the power that you raise this to increases every time, and this here decreases every time, so this plus this has to be kept constant. This plus this power is k plus 1, so 0 plus this power has to be k plus 1, so this is raised to the k plus first power. Now, what does this mean? If for this matrix norm, the norm of m inverse n is less than 1, then we know that raising that to the kth power and letting k go to infinity makes that coefficient go to 0, and therefore we know that our sequence of vectors converges to the right answer. But actually, it's a little bit simpler than that. If for any matrix norm, m inverse n in that norm is less than 1, then we know that in that norm, it doesn't need to be the same norm that we chose here, in that norm, this quantity goes to 0. And then by equivalence of norms, we know that every other norm, that quantity goes to 0 as well. And therefore, if we can find some norm for which we can prove that m inverse n in that norm is less than 1, then we know that our splitting method actually converges.